Yeah, let's get after it. Let's get after it. I mean, if the software and everything's working, you know, bam, catcher, let's go. Ready or not, here we go. This is all that's left of the kale. I mean, here's my smoothie today, and it's got like five pieces of kale in it. So you could tell I'm all in, right? And that 5 hour and 11 minute taping yesterday, my voice is kind of like, but my spirit is great. So I wanted to go to the beach. I wanted to do something today, like, but it's so stormy and rainy, and the Holy Spirit blocked me. I wanted to go to the beach, and I almost spun out my vehicle. I was in too much of a hurry, and the rear wheels lost some traction trying to pull out and make a turn. It's like, uh-oh. So I got blocked. I got blocked. So I just came home and said, I'm just going to sit here and, you know, like, okay, what do I do? So I didn't pout. I just, you know, it's like, I got to do something more important right now. It's got to really be very, very, very helpful. So I just sort of lay there on my bed and just said, okay, it's the wow. Wow. How can we move this pre-intensive forward? And the answer arrived. So we have the answer here. So it's storming out there, but we have shelter right here. You see, we have shelter. So as I was just quietly lying there and just going over the full stop in the wow practice, I just sort of went over it, and it became even clearer than ever before. Clearer than ever before. So what is the intensive in 218 for? I'll tell you who it's not for. It's not for those who want to impress others with all their spiritual knowledge. Okay, it's not for those at all. So, very simple. Here we're a one-trick pony. We just have one technique. Full stop in the wow. That's it. So I'm like the opposite of my dad. My dad was like a guru, a New Age guru. But he loved philosophizing and spiritual storytelling and all this kind of stuff. And people loved him. They just loved him. They thought he was the greatest thing ever. But it turned into kind of like a cult-like situation, actually. And it was quite troublesome. And he actually got scared, very scared. He was worried for his life. You know, the people were desperately depending on him to fix their problems. So I learned from his mistakes. I said, what? I told him he was wrong. I said, that's not the way. But it was so glamorous, you know, of playing the guru. Of here I am. I know so much. I know so much about spirituality. Oh, you know, ladies with swoons. So you're so wonderful, you know. All this kind of stuff. And I'm like in my room saying, no. That's not it. So I just stayed in my room. But the whole world said that, you know, that no, you need the spiritual knowledge, all this stuff. And I'm saying, no. It's way simpler than that. Just this. But the world rejects that. It wants a whole bunch of stuff. Now, I liken it to, let's say you're like a skateboarder or a surfer. And you get aerial. All these surfers are going aerials now. They come roaring off the bottom of the wave and come up and off the lip and then shoot up in the air, just flying up in the air. They're getting really good at that. And the angles of the cameras now are pretty amazing, just like they're flying in the air. They always come down, don't they? They come down, splat, and a lot of them wipe out when they come down. But they're trying to see how high they can get, how long they can get up in the air, and how many spins they can do in the air. Same thing with skateboarding, like vert ramps. All these aerial tricks, okay? They're doing all these tricks. And they're trying to do more and more, you know, different tricks. And better hang time and all this kind of stuff. And so they're really into that. All sorts of variety of stuff. Now, like for me, I would say I just have one trick. I'm a one-trick pony. Okay. My trick is I can just stay in the air as long as I want. I don't come down, okay? And so it's a whole different thing. I mean, they're just saying, how long can I stand before I come crashing down? And I'm saying, well, I could just not come crashing down at all. But so I don't need all these other tricks that impress people so much. You think, well, of course you have to come crashing down, but it's how long can you stay up there? So most of the world is beguiled by all this spirituality. And I never was beguiled by that. I just said, it's not where it's at. But it was too difficult. It's too difficult because nobody listens to me. The one trick pony say, that's boring. You know, you can stay up floating in there as long as you want. You know, we're doing something more important. We're sanctifying reality. We're in this quest to sanctify reality. Yeah, we're important. That's important. You know, we're on a super mission from God. God wants us to re-sanctify reality. Wow. So, I have just this one practice. That's it. And it's full stop in the well. And I can explain it even more clearly than ever. And that is to say, you must be in this mood, in this mindset. Get into this mindset mood where you refuse to draw any conclusions whatsoever about how whatever arises within you, how is this arising. You refuse to draw any conclusions. You refuse to search for any answers about that to draw a conclusion. You absolutely fence your mind in and say, no, I will not try to draw any conclusion. Did it arise through effort or no effort? I'm indifferent, completely indifferent. I refuse to entertain either option. I'm just in the wow, just wow. The experience is here, wow. That's it. How did it get here? I block that question entirely. Now, getting into this mood and the determination to do it. It's just a simple, it's a will. There's no how do you get into it really at all. You just do it. Now, I say that's the spiritual practice that we have here. That's to get ready for the intensive. This practice, you must be accomplished at it. You must be accomplished at it. Otherwise, there'll be nothing there for you, actually. You'll say, well, where's all the bells and whistles? Where's all the bells and whistles? How can I impress others? I'm not being taught how to impress others. I'm some sort of, you know, spiritual gadfly who knows so much. The physical practice, I'm finding, is balance. I looked at those foam rollers. I brought it back inside, but you could get them on Amazon. You can get either high density. I advise 6 inches by 18 inches long, or you can go up to 36 inches. But those are, you know, I don't think you need a 36-inch foam roller. I have one right here, actually. I don't use it. I could, because then I could practice walking along it. So, I mean, 36 would be okay. 6-inch by 36 would be okay, but 6 by 18, I would say, is like ideal. 6 by 12 is a little short, and you can go either medium density foam or high density foam on those. You can go just, and you can get like blue or black. They pretty much have a couple colors, not a lot of colors. But just go on Amazon, foam roller, and just practice balancing. Because what is that? You're staying in this neutral position, aren't you, kind of? You're, and the roller keeps wants to go this way or that way. It wants to roll in one or two directions, right? Rolling. A rolling pin. I have this one here. Maybe I should start using this to walk on. I will. Either it's going to roll forward or it's going to roll backwards, right? And this is a corollary to trying to draw conclusions. Did this experience arrive through effort or no effort? Right? So if it rolls this way, you say maybe it came through effort. And if it goes this way, maybe it came through no effort. So when you're balancing on this, you're really saying, I'm not going to roll either way. No matter what is thrown to me, I'm going to, you know, keep my balance on here, and I'm not going to roll either way. I'm just staying right in the wow of this. That's the wow. So we refuse to draw any conclusion, refuse to give any answer. How did this arise? How did this arise? Effort or no effort? So this is like, Is the path gradual or sudden? We refuse to draw any conclusion. Refuse to draw any conclusion whatsoever. So as you combine this full stop in the wild practice with balance practice, you are preparing for the full intensive. You're preparing for it properly. It's not about getting some credentials so you can be some big shot guru. It's not about that at all. It's about truly slamming the door on psychosis, where you will not be touched by psychosis. You will not be touched by it. You will not be touched by the severe mental illness. You will not be touched by it. It cannot get to you. And as a matter of fact, I recounted this dream experience I had, which was just so incredibly profound, where I found myself in this world of extreme psychotics. The entire world, there's massive amounts of people. They were all extremely psychotic. Just frighteningly psychotic, all of them. And I was trying to escape from this world, and I would almost escape, and then they would say, "No, you can't go." They would almost let me go, and then at the last second they say, "We decided we can't let you go." like a cat and mouse thing, you know, toying with me. I was like, it was just horrible, because I kept thinking, finally I'm going to get free of this lunatic asylum. And then suddenly they said, "No, you have to stay here," and they put me back, you know, in like in prison or something. It was just, you know, horrible ups and downs. Thinking, how can I get free? And then finally, once again, they said, "Okay, we're going to let you go." And I was saying, "Okay," and they say, "Go ahead, go." And I was saying, "Oh my gosh, they're going to stop me again, like they've done every last time." And I started walking across the road, and they didn't stop me. And I was free. And they just said, "Look, we trust you. Just go talk to the king. And we need help. Get some help for us, really. Ask the king to help us out. We're so desperate here. We're so dead." I said, "Okay, I will." And they set me free. Now, why did they set me free? Because this full stop in the wow practice, It's the only practice I've ever come across where the psychosis says it, okay, where you, as soon as you do this, you feel inside you feel there's a lack of that edginess, you know, that you feel within you. There's a lack of conflict within you. Both parts somehow it quiets down, and you're not trying to triumph over anything. You're refusing to triumph over anything. You refuse to draw sides. Okay? You refuse to draw sides. And that this relaxes this great dread within you, this psychosis within you. It says, okay, I'm okay with this practice. I'm okay with this. I am okay with this practice. And so since then this whole psychotic belief system, some call the ego, this way of practicing, it allows you to practice this way. Now, since we're trying to defeat the ego, not me and not here, but most in the world, since most are in this game of trying to triumph over the ego, trying to defeat the darkness, defeat it, this creates a polarization and a feeling of attack, right? But since I'm not trying to win anything, not trying to defeat anything, not trying to draw any conclusion at all, the feeling of being attacked, you know, threatened, disappears. So this feeling of threat disappears. And in place, there's like this deep gratitude. It's a different feeling arises. Confidence and gratitude. So I have had basically all of the experiences that you hear about in the spiritual path, the great experiences, I've had them all. For the most part, I would say. The real key ones, the heavyweight ones, because of this practice. And not for any other reason, actually. Because I allow it. Because there's the space to allow it. So whatever arises, I don't care what the breakthrough is, I just say, well, I'm not drawing any conclusions one way or another about this. I refuse to draw any conclusions. Just wow. Just wow. You know, is this the defeat of the ego or what happened? No, I'm not drawing any conclusions at all. Just wow. So, when we put ourselves into this mood, I am determined to not draw any conclusions whatsoever of how did this take place, why did it take place, what exactly is it, etc. I'm just letting it be whatever it is without any conclusions about it. Okay, I refuse to draw any conclusions about it. So the experiences that arise, it just is what it is. We refuse to label it. Say, well, this is this. I conclude that this is this. Or I conclude this. Or I conclude this. And we just use one label. Just wow, that's it. And that's sort of a very non-polarized term, isn't it? It's a very non-polarized term. Wow, wow, just wow, just wow, just wow. When we get in this mood of just wow, then guess what happens? This clarity arises. Because the feeling of threat has dissipated. You've dissipated a lot of this threat, polarization, threat feeling of I'm right, you're wrong, all this kind of stuff. And then just this natural clarity just arises. It's just, ah. Okay, wow. Wow, 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 wow. So, whatever is, is. And we're just getting out of the way of what is. That's all. We're just getting out of the way of what is. We're not trying to draw any conclusions about what is. We're just getting out of the way of what is, right? So it's free to just be as it is without any need for any label or conclusion at all. So this is, I've been like the orphan of the world, the Cinderella of the world, where nobody sees it, almost nobody sees this as the way. And so nobody listens, almost nobody. And they keep on striving and striving, and you end up on these forums where they're arguing and philosophizing and nitpicking and quibbling over terms and labels and stuff. And they're just, you know, this is how you go around the merry-go-round. You just keep going around the merry-go-round on the horse, going up and down, up and down, up and down, and you think you're getting somewhere. Ah, I'm going up, oh, now I'm going down, but now I'm going back up again. But you're just going around and around and around in the merry-go-round. This is so obvious. This has been going on since, you know, as long as we can look back. Whoops. The wind took the incense away. Where'd it go? It's gone. It's nice while it lasted. I was trying to light it, and this lighter wouldn't work. But I said, you know what? It's got to work. So I got like the 15th click. Finally, it went on. So, don't quit in this full stop in the wow. Oh, that first time this time. You might just think about this like a barbecue lighter here, and click, 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 click. Ah, for some reason I can't get it. I finally shook it up and tried a few more times, and finally, boom! There's the flame. And lit the incense. Don't give up. Just feel like, I've got to light this stick of incense. I really want this stick of incense. I really want it. So there's just got to be some fluid in there. It's just got to work. It's got to work. And it will. It will. We have to have this feeling. I want something that actually works for me. I really want something that'll work. I don't care what other people think about it, okay? If it's not glamorous enough for them. I want something that's actually going to work for me. I really want that. And the problem is, you have all these glamorous gurus and teachers saying all this stuff. And you think, well, I have to do what they say because, you know, that's glamorous and they're getting a lot of attention from that. But do we really need all that attention? Is that where it's at? Or do we really, what we really want is truly liberation from psychosis, from mental instability? Now, the mind is not unstable at all. It's perfectly stable. So why do we have this instability? We think we have it. Because we're imagining another mind, this unstable mind, this mind that's supposedly capable of sanctifying reality, which is impossible. So to hide the impossibility of it, we imagine that the mind is just unstable and therefore incapable, but it can gain stability, and then it will be capable. You see? That... Yeah, it's still cold. It's cold. It's nice little storm here, actually. I just like something like burning, like a stick of incense. I'll light another one. That was nice. So we see this, but refuse to draw any conclusions about it. Okay. Refuse to draw any conclusions. Refuse. to analyze it and further, are just, you know, you can tell the mood right away if you're trying to analyze, and if you're refusing, you just feel calm, you feel relaxed, you feel calm, and you feel okay. You feel, say, I'm okay with this. And that part of you, that fearful part of you, it feels okay. It says, no, I'm okay. Just don't try and defeat me, okay? Just, yeah. And as long as you stay in that, you'll feel the smoothness within you, that you feel okay. I need a heater out here. I don't want to catch a cold. Well, you don't catch colds that way, really. But you hear the humble ones are the ones that succeed. They're not out there trying to impress everybody by the vast scope of their knowledge, and they know 1,000 different practices and all this kind of stuff. That's not it. So when we refuse to draw any conclusion, there's no toehold for psychosis to take. Everything is just neutral, almost, you might say. No polarization can take place. And then what happens? Well, you get, guess what? You get used to this feeling of smoothness. You get used to it. The polarization only arises from continuity fear, which we're afraid of this feeling of smoothness, which is really the inherent sanctity of reality. So we must allow ourselves to get used to this feeling of it's all smooth just as it is. Without trying to do anything about it, draw any conclusions, without even the conclusion of it's effortlessly smooth. Not even that conclusion. Is it, did we get here through effort or no effort? Neither one. Refuse to draw any conclusion about that. Did we arrive or not arrive? Refuse to draw any conclusion about that. Because what we're going for is not some mental concept of smoothness, but the actual feeling of it. As soon as we go into our thinking about, I'm in smoothness. Now, how did I get here? Well, I got here by no effort. You know, okay. We've shifted out of the feeling of it. And then the continuity fear is in control. Yeah. What's this? It's the kale. Okay. So, full stop in the wow. One practice. Do your balance work. Yep. One practice. And drink your, put kale in your smoothies. One nutritional practice. There you go. Nutrition, exercise, spiritual practice. Just one thing. Three. That's what the Buddha said. Three. Oh, you need three. Well, I said, what are you talking about? You need a lot. He said, no. Just three. I said, we're putting the band back together. You don't want the horn section? You want all that stuff? No. Three's enough. So we have one nutritional tip. We're drinking smoothies and throw kale in there. Okay? It's good for you. You don't have to throw all the stalks in. You can cut off the leafy part and then just forget about the stalks, actually. And it's fine. It's not a problem. Very simple. Take that step. It's a healthy step. I was in this office today, and someone had a calendar up, and it was a Giants calendar. There was Hunter Pence. Hunter Pence is my man. I love Hunter Pence. I love Hunter Pence. He's a beautiful, beautiful spirit. And he's the guy. He's the kale monster. He's the kale crusher. I mean, he's the guy that brought kale to Major League Baseball. I mean, he just eats a massive amount of kale. And that's, you know, he was so into that. Everybody said, "You're nuts! What is going on?" And now it's become such a huge thing around the world. But he really was one of the, you know, pioneers of this nutrition in baseball of kale. And we all laughed at him. You know, we laughed at him. But he's such a beautiful soul. Eventually, I said, you know, maybe we should listen to him a little bit. Except when it comes to coffee, because he's a coffee maniac. Caffeine addict. That's not good, Hunter. You got to stop that. Seriously. But there he was on the calendar, Hunter Pence, for the Giants. Mr. Kale. So I took that and said, hey, Kale. Yeah, let's just go with Kale. It's pretty simple. And it's a tough one. I've had a real tough time with that. But I did it again this morning. I had this smoothie all set up. And I said, wait a minute. I got to stuff some kale in there. I did it. It tastes fine. It tastes great. It's not a problem at all. And this is just sort of a nutritional thing that if you're like crushing kale, people are going to leave you alone. The psychotics will leave you alone. You know, the health psychotics. They'll leave you alone. They'll say, okay, you're okay with me. You're okay. And if you're doing balance work, the yoga psychotics, you know, the fitness psychotics will leave you alone. They say, oh, you're into balance work? Oh, that's really cool. That's really good. Okay. And if you're into full stop on the wow, it's like, you know, no conclusions. Refusing to draw any conclusions. Just, you know, the spirit of abidance, we'll call it. I'm into just the spirit of abidance. Full stop in the wow is the practice. The spirit of abidance, you might say. They'll say, oh, yeah, that's really good. And they'll leave you alone. They'll leave you alone, which is great. But if you're not into those things, those knock, they're just so simple, that knocks everything else out, right? But if you're not into that rest of that stuff, they'll say, hey, where's the horn section? You know, you say, how many guys you got in the orchestra? How many players? You say, oh, just three. Just three? What? So that's interesting, that meeting I had with the Buddha. And he said, okay. I said, let's get the band back together. He says, yeah. Let's say, okay. How many? I said, okay. What do you recommend as far as a band? How many people in the band? And he says, well, just three. Three's all you need. Three's all you need. He makes the fourth, so to speak. But so nutrition, just slam the door on all the health freaks. Okay, slam the door. Just smoothie with kale. I eat kale every day. Oh my gosh, you know, well, you're good. You know, you're good. You're good. They might, you know, say, well, yeah, wow, but they don't press it. No, that shuts the door. I really crush it every day. You know, I mean, it's awesome. You know, respect, mad respect. They'll give you mad respect. And you know, we'll do other stuff with smoothies and stuff. But the habit, just the kale thing, that you got gravitas right away. Same thing then with the balance work. If you say, you know what, I find that, you know, it's really the coolest full body workout there is the balance work. I do a lot of balance work. That's what I'm focusing on, balance work. You know, right away. I've talked to a lot of guys, fitness people, and I'd say that I'm really into, and they're just like, wow. That's great, man. That's really, really, really cool. And they leave you alone. They leave you alone. It's, everything's fine. But you got to actually be doing it. You can't just be a poser. You know, we're not posers here. We're actually doing it. So when you're actually doing it, you get this confidence. You really get this confidence instead of a poser confidence. See, poser confidence need this. Sort of a glamour guru to say, well, I'm with, you know, I can point to the glamour guru, that's why I have confidence or something. Then there's a dependency kind of relationship arises. But you actually do the practice, then you'll have your own confidence. your own confidence. Now, it's great to be with the guru, the Dharma kings. Absolutely. A little bit here, a little bit there helps out tremendously. But we have to, you know, see, wherever we go, we carry our habits with us. Doesn't matter if you go to Hawaii or whatever. You're still going to, you know, habits travel. Habits travel. So if you really are actually doing these key practices, you'll just feel like, you know, I can hold my own in this world. I can hold my own. And the psychotics can't really get to me. They can't. And they won't want to. It's amazing. Because really, the psychosis is just a false mind, an imaginary mind we've made up. Our real mind is perfect. There's nothing wrong with it at all. And so when you're saying, hey, I'm not judging psychosis, okay? I'm not attacking it or anything. The true mind can feel that, recognize, and says, okay. So it's just continuity fear. I'm just getting familiar. I'm just easing into, you know, true mind, real mind, just letting that happen. It seems to be they're okay with that. It doesn't really bother them. It's only when you're trying to kill that mind, that, you know, get rid of it, destroy it, that's where this energy commotion, energy of commotion arises. And you could, if you feel like you're defeating it, you could feel like a really big shot. Okay, real big shot. Walking around, everybody thinks you're like king and queen of the hill. But I guarantee you that only lasts for so long. That only lasts for so long. And it's a nervous energy. It's a nervous kind of energy. It's not smooth. It's not really smooth. It's not the smoothed outness. Buddha has this smoothed outness. It was just completely smooth, effortlessly smooth. He wasn't trying to be smooth. It just was. It just is. Still functional. Free and functional. Now, when you're doing those three every day, really consistently, you never get away from it. Then you could do other stuff too. I did some stairs today, about 600, but I didn't do anything fancy because my knee hurts if I try to do too much impactful stuff. I did something different. Actually, I'll tell you what I did. This is really cool. I used my balance exercise on the stairs. What I did was I would step with one leg. I'd step up stepping three at a time, and I'd go up on that front foot, and then I'd step up, and I'd balance on that one foot for just a little while. I'd just balance and hold. So I'd hold the balance, and then I'd step with my other foot onto the stair. I'd step with the other foot, and then I'd take the other foot and step three, and go on one leg and just balance there. And then step with the other foot. And I did that the whole way, 300 stairs that way. 300, it was great. It requires mental concentration, determination. And I wasn't so winded because I was stopping on each step of three. I'd stop and get my balance. So it didn't really wipe me out as far as I wasn't all out of breath when I got there. So that shows how to integrate your balance training with what you're doing, whatever you're doing. A lot of times I stand on one leg. If I'm in a store, I'll be standing on one leg. I'll kind of be in, they hardly note, no one notices it really, because you just take your foot off the ground, one foot off the ground a little bit, just stand on one leg. So I'm doing a lot of one-legged practice now. I'm doing leg raises, standing on leg and raise my leg 20 times on each side like that. I'm hopping around in circles on one leg. Be careful with your knee. Put some sideways strain on your knee, lateral strain on your knee. Actually, I'm standing on the roller on one leg now. just one leg. So one training on one leg, balancing on one leg, all this stuff, this is, you know, really important. Balance training is where it's at. You don't have to do all the other stuff, but if you're doing other stuff, practice balance training on whatever you're doing. Whatever you're doing. I go to a parking lot, and you know those concrete bumpers they have where the car stops in front. What I do is, if there's one there, I'll jump up on it and just practice balancing on it. You know, if the mood is there, and then I'll just like go on one foot or something, and this trains your mind, your whole being has. You have to focus on balance. You have to really be present. As soon as you let your mind wander, you know what? Whoa! I fell. So just, you could, so easy. You say, well, how do I do this? Next time you're standing, just take one foot just off the ground an inch, and stand on one foot. It's that easy. How could that be difficult? How could there be anyone in the world that's there in a wheelchair? I understand that. But how could anyone otherwise say, oh, I can't do that? I mean, what? That's, I don't understand. Don't even, just lift. Stand. You're standing up, or you're walking. Just stand, and just take one foot off the ground, and one inch, half an inch, whatever. It's just, you unweight one foot, take it off the ground. And if you start to fall, put it back. Just, it's so easy. That's how you start. You start with little baby steps. You start with baby steps. And so I'll just do all this little stuff, you know, whatever I could think of. To try to do something balance-wise without trying to hurt my knee again. I got to thank my knee for slowing me down. Somehow it got bad somehow to slow me down, I believe. You know, it's I thank, whenever something happens, thank it. Thank you, knee, for slowing me down. I appreciate it. Did a great job. When you get sick, thank the sickness. Say, thank you for coming. I really appreciate it. I know this is helping me out tremendously. I may not be aware of it, except in hindsight I'll see how helpful you were. Thank you so much. And then become aware of what is it doing to slow you down. And then if you agree to be slowed down or change direction or something, then guess what? It'll go away. It'll go away. And so I'm gaining more and more and more stability on one leg. It's noticeable. Okay, after a year of working out, before I just couldn't, you know, I just, whoa, topple. Now it's like I could just stand there. It's like I move all around. My body's just like all over the place, and it's like I just like no problem. I'm not even falling at all. It's like, what? That's amazing. I said, I don't know how I'm doing it. It's just not a problem anymore. So balance is really quite something extraordinary. It really is. It involves the psyche to a very strong extent. It's not like just pumping some iron, okay? No, this really is a it's like a mental discipline as much as a physical discipline. Tai Chi is an example of that sort of thing. All these motions they do and things like that. But we're not saying you have to do Tai Chi or anything like that. But try to put yourself in situations where your balance is being compromised in some way, where you feel like I really have to concentrate to keep my balance here. And don't compete with others, because different body types have different ease as far as balance goes, really, depending on if how wide you are, how short you are. You know, men and women have different bone structures. A lot of them do. It's just and it might be real easy for someone to do that, and you might have a body structure where it's quite difficult. So whatever your body structure is, challenge yourself as far as balance goes. And have fun with it. Have fun with it. And that's something you could do all the time, every day. It's easy. Wherever you are, you could just try something. You're waiting in line at somewhere. Just like lift your one foot up, kind of tuck it behind the other one, and just kind of like see how long you can just stand there, and just be determined. I'm not going to lose my balance. I'm going to keep my balance. I'm focus on the foot that's on the ground, not on the one that's not. Don't worry about what it's doing. Just the one that's on the ground. Just keep yourself focused, centered on that foot in your mind. So we have these three super easy practices, focuses. I mean, you know, you can't miss it. You can't miss it. If you can count to three, you can do it. Nutrition, exercise, spiritual practice. Nutrition, exercise, spiritual practice. Really simple. And you might think, no, I want to be really advanced. I want like 20 different things to do. But these three basics, you can do balance training in all sorts of ways, actually. And that doesn't mean you can't do strength training also. It doesn't. It's just that that's just an elective kind of thing. It's not a core part of the core curriculum. So like in order to graduate, you need to do these three core classes, right? And then the other stuff, you can have electives if you want to. You don't have to do the electives. It's not necessary. In order to pre-qualify, you need to do these, be really good at these three areas. Your balance, really good at balance training. Now, however your balance is, it's the training. You're good at balance training. You train yourself. You know, like, hey, I'm competent. I know I can get on this. I do this. I do this every day. I'm able to train myself in balance. Nutrition training. You're able to get with this nutritional thing, which is good for you. There's no question. It's healthy for you. And you're able to eat in a way that's not causing, I mean, the sattvic diet, they say, is really good. I have a very sattvic diet, actually. Basically, I'd say almost really, maybe entirely, you could say, entirely sattvic diet. I knocked out eggs. I finally took them out of there, and that was, I think, it. But sipping a little bit, you know, during the day, and don't overload your system with these big meals, that's just, it's not good. Systematic under-eating is really healthy. Let your stomach shrink. Shrink your stomach and under-eat. Shrink your stomach and under-eat. And get your kale so the health freaks, maniacs, will leave you alone. Because isn't that a huge obsession in the world right now, health? Huge obsession. So this is so much wisdom here because we understand the obsessions of psychosis, and we're not battling against them, saying they're bad, they're wrong. We're patting on the back and say, thank you very much. You know, yeah, I'm doing my kale. Thanks a lot. I know it's really healthy. I appreciate it. And yeah, thanks for all the exercise. I'm doing my balance work really great. And it's smoothed out that way. It's all smoothed out. But there are just, and we're not demonizing psychosis, okay? This simply, we understand how it arose. We're trying to do the impossible. That's all. It's just whimsicality. But it gets twisted into so many knots, you know, it becomes very brutal and very fearful and scary. It becomes weird and scary. So we want to make sure we take the edge off of that stuff, you know, the stuff in the world, going on in the world. We don't want to like feel like we're in opposition to the world, okay? We don't want to feel that. We're drawing no conclusions at all. We're just in the mood of blocking any conclusion. And when we do that, it ultimately defaults to what is. It ultimately simply defaults to what is, which needs no conclusion. Is there some conclusion about reality? Supposed to conclude something? What is there? It doesn't need a conclusion. It doesn't need a label. So if we block all labels, good and bad, what will arise in us is just simply what is. Now, I will put up, well, I'm considering it. So we're not these elitists who's saying, well, we must only have, we can't have anything, our attention cannot be on anything at all in the world, so to speak. You got to be careful. Very careful what your attention goes on. That's true. But if your grace guides you, you put your little attention on this, that's okay. I watched this video last night. It was pretty amazing. It was just like, I was just like, wow. It was this motorcyclist riding this super famous wave, Japu in Tahiti, on a motorcycle. I said, what? Now you got to be kidding me. I said, this is not possible. What are you talking about? It was the most surreal thing I've ever seen. It was like Robbie Madison or Madsen, something like that. He's like, you know, super famous, really great motocross rider, X Games hero and all this kind of stuff. And they showed him like going through Tahiti, the mountains kind of coming out through a field. And suddenly he just drove the motorcycle into this river and was just going right through the middle of the river. And then he took this river right out to the ocean and then he just went straight out into the ocean. I was like, what? Is this like optical? How'd they do that? And then I saw that he had some sort of like skis on his motorcycle, a bunch of like ski-like things. And then his back wheel had sort of some really like paddles on it, kind of. The tire was set such that it had all these little these fins kind of on it. So it was that's like propelling like a paddle wheel in a riverboat kind of thing. And then these fins were stabilizing, allowing the motorcycle to skim across the surface of the ocean. So then he rode out to this great big wave break. And then he actually rode this wave on the motorcycle. And then he caught another one. It was huge. And it closed out on me, but he rode the white water, and it caught up to him, but somehow he was able to accelerate the bike, and he outrode it somehow, and he like escaped it, or maybe they caught up to him eventually. That was the end of the video. This video has like 26 million views, and it's like the perfect like brutal movie, you know, for the brutal mind, the beastie minded, the beast. I say the world is like going in. Psychosis is going in this like beastie way, and then like mental illness way, severe mental illness way, kind of where people are just so weird, bizarre, just really sick, deviantly sick or something. And then the others like beast, sort of a beastish, modish thing, where like doing all this extreme sports and things like that. So this is like the extreme sport people love this sort of stuff. Like, oh my gosh, you know. Danger, thrills, you know, extreme dangers and extreme stuff like that. Bungee jumping, jumping out of planes, they love this stuff. And dog surfing, I hear, is like a really big thing now. They're training all their dogs to surf. That's another thing that they're trying to calm their psychosis down that way by being like animals. Like, what can this animal do? And they're really kind of rough and tumble and coarse. And the music, it's like surf, the kind of surf music they have these, it's just terrible. It's just horrible. I have to turn it off. It's all so, in the gutter, you know. It's, oh, gosh, it's not good. But these guys, you know, they've got tattoos all over, right? They're all the guys, those people, they're full of tattoos, doing all this extreme stuff. That's a style in the world, okay. So, watching this video, I just said, okay, that was cool. I got a good laugh. The photography was beautiful. The pictures, what they did a fabulous job. And I said, okay, had a good laugh. It was a very cool thing on that. So, but now I say, okay, I mean, I understand it is what it is. Tip of the hat, you know, just tip of the hat to those folks. We don't have to wallow in any of that stuff. I watch surf videos of, you know, guys surfing. Some of them are the music's so terrible, it's hard. I have to turn it off. And you know, just the guys involved are pretty rough bunch. You know, just kind of like you don't really, I can't really relate to them. They're personality-wise, it's typical surfer guys, you know. But the beauty of the photography and the video and everything, you got to tip your hat to them. Tip your hat. I mean, these guys went out in Nazaré, and it was just crazy conditions in Portugal. The waves were so dangerous, so huge. The wind was 30, 45 miles an hour offshore, and it's just like they did it, filmed it all, and it was like pretty amazing. And the guys are saying, hey, look, I'm an ocean explorer. You know, this is what I do. And yeah, they're daredevils. But just the majesty and the beauty of it all, you know, you can relate with that. It's okay to see some beauty in nature, some majesty and the stuff that people are doing. It's, you know, okay, that's fine. So you're a little bit hip to that. You know, it's not like, but you have to be careful. You have to be careful. But you just realize, okay, this is what, you know, the mind, this is a remedy the mind is attempting. It's not what works, but we're not condemning them for trying it. Okay, so we don't condemn the world. We don't condemn what our brothers and spirit are doing. We don't condemn them. We just pat them on the back and say, you know, it's okay, everything's still okay, your mind is still perfect, don't worry, it's just continuity fear. They're just caught up in continuity fear, desperately trying to outrace their psychosis. Trying to outrace psychosis is psychosis. It's only when you stop and turn around and face it that it shifts into just mental illness, but not psychosis. I mean, it shifts out of psychosis. It's only when you turn around and confront your psychosis and just say, okay, we're going to have to get to know one another, and you know, we're just going to have to give up this ridiculous fight, okay, and we're just going to somehow resolve this. Then it stops being a psychosis right then and there. In Christianity, it's called repentance. As soon as you repent, you're no longer psychotic. That's a fact. It's an absolute fact. You're not trying to run from it. You're not trying to defeat it. You're just saying, "Look, I'm not gonna. I don't want to keep it trying to defeat you. But I'm not gonna run away from you. I'm just going to sit here, you know, and we're going to be friends in some way. I'm going to make friends with myself. This is just, I can't keep going on like this." And then just a sigh of relief. And I said, look, I understand this is being generated by continuity fear. That's it. This whole thing, this whole stupidity is just being generated by continuity fear. I'm going to work on it, and I'm going to evaporate it bit by bit. I'm going to gradually but briskly evaporate it. And that's what I'm going to do. Then you realize you're going to be okay. Everything's going to be okay. You're not going to drug the psychosis to death, right? You're not going to drug it to death, no. If you have to use some medications, that's fine. Just forgive yourself for it and say, I'm going to work on the spiritual, wow, these three steps, I'm going to work on those. And I'm not going to draw any conclusions. At least in the practice, okay. Obviously, you will become aware of what is. You know, it is what it is. Reality simply is. Your clarity will increase greatly. But as far as practicing goes, you get in the mood of, I'm not going to draw any conclusions. I will refuse. Jesus shows up and you just say, hey, okay, Jesus is here, but How did he get here? Why is he here? I refuse to entertain any conclusions about the situation whatsoever. I absolutely refuse. He's just here. Okay? Now, we're not trying to be cute and say, well, I refuse to say that he's here or not. I mean, there's an experience present. It's present. Okay? The presence is the present. Whatever is present, but I am not going to say, why is it present? How is it present? You know, I'm not going to analyze the presence. I'm not going to analyze whatever's present. I'm going to refuse to analyze it. And then I'm going to drink my kale. And then I'm okay. And then I'm going to do some balance work. And then I'm going to feel like, you know what? I'm cool enough. I don't really need to do anything else. I'm cool enough. I'm not abandoning the world. I'm not attacking the world. I'm cool enough. I can hang with it. Would I like to go to Hawaii and watch John Florence surf? Yeah, that'd be pretty cool. That'd be pretty cool. I'd hang out on the beach. I'd be drinking my kale smoothie. I'd be standing on one leg, kind of stretching, doing my stretching, and then just one leg stuff. You know, somebody says, what are you doing? You say, well, I'm doing some sort of like hybrid Tai Chi sort of thing, balance work. Sort of like Tai Chi is balance work. It's kind of my own, I've got my own practice. You know, I've just designed, you know, just whatever works for me. Just balance work, you know. And then you could watch John Florence at Pipeline. Yeah, that'd be pretty cool. Yeah, why not? He's a cool surfer. He's a cool surfer. And he's marketable. That's what they like. he's marketable. He's not one of these just ultra gnarly surfer dude guys that just, you know, is not really marketable. He's you know, golden haired boy and young, and he's relaxed and he handles himself well. He's not really too gross or crude. A little bit, you know, young guy, teenager type of mentality is, but marketable. I mean, companies want him to represent them, that kind of thing. Like a Kelly Slater was very marketable. And these guys are just have the persona, which is, you know, people comfortable, can be comfortable. So, I tend to, like, it's like if your tendency is to be too analytical, too philosophical, it's better you hang out with the brutal folks a little bit. Okay. That keeps you away from the philosophical folks, which you want to stay away from them. Whereas if you're like a brutal type, it's better to hang out with the philosophical types a little bit. So that's why you get a lot of people going to see these gurus and stuff in the world. You look at the audience, a lot of them like kind of brutal types, sort of. You think like, huh. Well, that helps keep them a little balanced. Keeps them away from too much hanging out with too much brutal stuff. They need to get out of that, kind of. Helps them. It helps them. So you might be wondering, what in the heck am I doing like with like watching skateboard movies and surf videos and sort of just on the edge of that? Because it keeps me away from the other stuff. The gurus, the philosophers, the new agers, all this kind of stuff. It keeps me away from that. So it's my temptation is to, you know, it's easy for me to blah, 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 get, you know, I could just like excel in that. It's like easily get into that. That's what I want to stay away from. That's my Achilles heel. I have to stay away from that. Stay away from it. So it'd be better if I just sitting on the North Shore of Hawaii in a shack watching the surfers than it would be if I was, you know, at in London, you know, going to see some guru, or I don't know where, like where, or Rishikesh. I'm hanging out with the gurus in Rishikesh. Yeah, it would be a lot better for me because I already have the practice. I already know what's right. I already know what works. It's I have to stay away from sophisticated stuff that doesn't work. Stuff that doesn't work, but it's really sophisticated. It's fancy, so people will be impressed. Like, oh, you're in Rishikesh. Oh, you're going to the guru. Oh, you got all this knowledge, but you know all these different ways, practices. And you go, oh, wow. You got up there in the hot seat, and who am I? And you know, oh, you know the inquiry and things. Oh. You know, people are like, ooh, you're spiritual. You know, oh, you got some nice beads. Where'd you get those beads? Oh, that's really cool. You know, that kind of stuff. Or you say, nah, I was just hanging out. I'm just like taking some video of some surfers or the waves or whatever. It's like, huh? Nah, you know, whatever. You know, you're just like some kind of low life or something. I mean, you've got nothing going on spiritually. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. And the reverse is true also. If you know, if you're kind of a brutal type, your psychosis is more of a brutal type, personality type, like, then you might be hanging out with all these sort of glamorous guru types, and oh yeah, I'm into that now. And on the other brutal types, we say, what? What do you think you are, man? You think you're too good for us or something? You're like, what the heck? You're going to these, you know? And you might be saying, well, I got these nice beads, I got these crystals, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And that it's just a way of keeping you away from the old crowd that, you know, it's too easy for you to get into that crowd, right? The party crowd, the brutal party crowd sort of thing. That's like your natural tendency to get into that, to try to avoid psychosis, run from it, how you think you're running away from it. So I never quite saw that clearly before. That this answers a lot of questions. I think, like the New Agers, I said, what? And they're like really just like brutal kind of pagan types, you know. It's like, what's going on with that? Well, they're trying to get away from that brutal pagan type. Just as far as, you know, it's an avoidance thing, which is good for them. It's an avoidance technique they're using. But usually, I'm pretty much like the only one hanging out just on the edges of just. I don't really hang out with the brutal types at all. I used to when I was younger a little bit, but it's more just on the edges of it. It just kept me away from the philosophers, you know. Really, I had to because they were driving me crazy. They were the problem. They were what was causing a conflict within me, because I said, wait a minute, there's not two minds, there's only one, and the one mind is not conflicted, and what you're teaching is not the one mind at all. And they said, no, but this is also correct, right? And look how fancy it is. I said, oh God, you know, please. So I was trying to take refuge, you know, in the low lifes, almost, just like, not that I enjoyed it. I don't really enjoy surfers, their attitude. I really don't. I don't. So I was just on the periphery of it, just so I could hide from the philosophers. Nobody knows that I'm good at it. Because they find out you're good at it. Oh, well, they want to talk forever. Oh, you're one of us. No, I'm not. No, I am not. Just because I'm very facile with words and concepts, and quick, and dexterous, and coordinated with all this stuff, that doesn't mean that it's right. That doesn't mean I want to do it. It's like if anyone finds out you're like a great piano musician, or, you know, oh, you got to play for us. That's another thing. The musical crowd. Holy cow! Don't let them ever know that you can do something good, because they'll like jump you. Like, oh, gotta play for us. Well, you gotta make us feel good. Music is another drug that we use to try to run away from our psychosis, medicate it. You can just say, no, I just vocalize to nature or something. I don't vocalize for any audiences or stuff. You just have to stay away from that crowd. I do, that's for sure. Maybe that bad music is good. It's like surf music. Ah, terrible. Yeah. At least it's not. It's good. Yeah, I have terrible musical tastes. So you gotta make sure you downplay what you're good at in terms of the world, in terms of defending against psychosis, because everybody's looking for a better defense, right? And if you are really good at some defense, we're all good at some defense, aren't we? They're going to want to grab a hold of you and say, oh my gosh, here, let's put you on a throne and we'll worship you, but just teach us this defense against psychosis. We really want to be defended against it. But we're not into defending against it at all. We're just evaporating continuity fear. That's all. We're not attacking ourselves at all. As Jesus says, the way to salvation is forgive yourself. Forgive yourself, actually. That's his terminology. Here I just say, just evaporate the continuity fear. Just be neutral. Don't take sides. Who's right and who's wrong? Just put that on the back burner. You know, so I'm not concluding who's right or who's wrong. Is it effort that attains reality or no effort that attains it? I'm not drawing any conclusion who's right and who's wrong about that. So this is the really the way. It really is the way. It actually works. And of course, that's what everyone's afraid of. It actually works. They say, nah, it's an abyss. Well, don't label. Is it abyss? Refuse to look. Oh, here's another thing. Refuse to look whether it's an abyss or not. I refuse to look. I know I'm here. So if I'm here, how could it be an abyss? Total abyss. If there's a total abyss, there wouldn't be anybody there. So another way to look at it is I refuse to say where I am. Well, am I in an abyss or not an abyss? I'm not going to look. I'm not going to look. I'm not going to draw any conclusions about how it happened or where I am. I'm not going to draw any conclusions about where I am. So this is another way of really, you might feel really comfortable doing it that way. I refuse to draw any conclusions of where I am. So it's not, or who I am. I refuse to draw any conclusions of who I am, what I am, where I am, how I am. Have I always been this way, or did I get to be this way? I refuse to draw any conclusions in any direction, really. 360-degree wow, no conclusions. It's just wherever I look, it's just wow that blocks conclusions. Block drawing conclusions. Refuse to draw any conclusions. Refuse to draw any conclusions. Now, you might have others who are just drawing all sorts of conclusions. Let them run wild. That's you refuse to draw any conclusions as you're practicing. You refuse. And I guarantee you that you will find peace of mind. You will find what you're looking for as it is. The spirit of abundance will be upon you. In this way. And there won't be any more psychosis to run from or to medicate or to treat. It'll be gone. And you will be free and functional. You will be free and functional. You will just say, free and functional. You won't even need to say, I am free and functional. You'll just free and functional. This is what the experiencing is, free and functional. This is what is. I don't need to say it's I am this or I am not this. It's just free and functional. That's what's present. That's what's present. Kale time. My voice is getting a little tired. I couldn't sing well today. I think that 5 hours must have tired my voice out. Free and functional. So maybe as a motto for this pre-intensive, we could just say free and functional. Free and functional. Not I am free and functional, but not anything, just free and functional. This is the feeling that I got today. I came up, I said, what if I had this experience and through the grace of Manjushri, I had this this experience, and there was no I, so to speak. There was no searching self. The imaginary mind was simply not there. Okay, you might put it this way. The imaginary mind was simply gone. And I was free of it. Or just, there was, you could say freedom. The feeling was just free. Okay, there's freedom. And then the recognition was there's also functionality. I said, functionality is still present. Whatever functionality needs to be take place, not a problem. So functionality is still present. I'm free of this, you know, false mind. It's gone. There's no trace of it anywhere. So the words just came up, free and functional. Free and functional. Wow. Free and functional. Wow. Wow. Free and functional. So this is a very powerful mantra, you might say. So people might say, well, what's your mantra? We say, wow, free and functional. Wow, free and functional. So we're leaving out the I am free and functional. We're taking a step even more powerful, just free and functional. Wow. Because this will be the experiencing that is present. Free and functional. Wow. Free and functional. Wow. So there you go. I mean, you're hip. You got your mantra. You got your practice. You got your exercise. You got your nutrition. You got your guru. Who's the guru? Manjushri. You can say Manjushri. Very little baggage there, especially in the West. I never even heard of the name Manjushri until recently. it doesn't mean anything to me in particular as far as baggage goes. But the presence that is referred to as Manjushri by the Buddhists, I've certainly experienced it. Really, it's just the presence of yourself, the true self, the one self. It's that. It really is. And it's this eternal youthfulness. It's eternal life, really. And it works. I mean, it's there. It's true. You can call it whatever you like, but Manjushri in Sanskrit, I think it is gentle glory. Really fits beautifully. It fits beautifully, and it has it works. We need something that's not pure abstraction, and for me, Jesus Christ would be the same. But the baggage in the Western world is such that, you know, wow. It's tough to say, you know, who are you hanging out with? Well, Jesus Christ. And it's like, but if you say, well, it's just Manjushri, the Buddhists, you know, call it Manjushri, gentle glory. I'm hanging out with this gentle glory, appealing to this gentle glory, Manjushri, Bodhisattva. They kind of say, oh, Bodhisattva, Manjushri. Okay, well, there's not a whole bunch of negativity. We've been trained in the Western world, and basically around the world, a lot of people have been trained to be very negative toward Jesus Christ. Very mixed emotions. Very mixed emotions, right? Whereas Manjushri, it's just like, there's no emotions really there at all for me. It's just, except just like I feel this just, wow. I feel this wow. There's no practices or techniques or stuff I need to show off to. Like, I don't have anything. It's easy for me to just go and just sit with Manjushri and just surrender. I don't have anything to showcase to you at all. Some Buddhist practice or anything, or mantras, or, you know, the Buddhists are so caught up in all these techniques and practices, and they may, you know, they go to Manjushri, they might want to think that, okay, now I got to dissolve into Manjushri, I got to do this. For me, I just feel like, okay, your will, not mine. Because I know you're really what I am. You're my true self. This eternal youth that is infinitely playful. This gentle glory that is infinitely playful. And his characteristic is beautiful voice. Vocalization is so beautiful. So we bring in, as far as artistically, our practice would be vocalization here. So we're trying to cover the various bases, and so we feel, you know, well-rounded. We have the nutrition, the exercise, the spiritual practice, the mantra, the mantra is just, wow, free and functional. We have that, and then we have the guru, Manjushri. And then we have the creativity, which is vocalization. Creativity, which is vocalization. Okay, so we're easing into this, you see. And I'm saying, oh yeah, okay, we've got it. We've got it. Vocalization, which I'm very practiced in. Been doing it, you know, for most of my life, really. I used to do silent vocalization. I didn't want anyone to hear me. So I just like, just, you know, quietly, so no one could hear. When I was young, I did it all the time. I could just vocalize just anything and everything, actually. I could vocalize an entire symphony in my mind. But I didn't want anyone to hear me. And finally, I started singing out loud when I was about maybe 20-something, really. Maybe 20-something, I remember. 21, 22, around that, those times. And I was like, uh-oh, I don't want anyone to hear me. I better be quiet. I don't want people to hear me vocalizing well, because they'll grab a hold and tear you to pieces. People are desperate for that medication, you know, good vocalists. But then I continued in my room quietly, so no one could hear me, just vocalizing out loud. I've been doing it ever since then. You know, 40 years or so of vocalization. I just enjoy it. It's just, it's beautiful. There's a flow to it. There's a creativity to it. So this is what I'm able to recommend as far as creativity is. You can really practice vocalization. For instance, I had a song on today. I listen. I usually vocalize to the Beach Boys. It's very conducive to beautiful vocalization. Their songs, you know, the lyrics. Yeah, it's all teenage pop type of lyrics. You know, how, you know, the boy loves the girl so much, and, you know, and does she love him, and she went away, and, you know, she's so beautiful, and this kind of stuff. Yeah, that's what sold records back then. But the arrangements are so genius by Brian Wilson, and the harmonies are the best I've ever heard. There's nothing that can touch them. And so it's very conducive to vocalization, actually. So that I've been using that my whole life, the Beach Boys. And I haven't found anything better or even as good, actually. They really stand at this high water mark in terms of, for me, inducing vocalization. I could just vocalize, go along, whatever, you know, I just spin off in any which direction. It just seems so effortlessly and so easy because they got your back. I mean, you're going to sound great no matter what you do. Right? You got their harmonies behind you. Whatever you're singing, man, it's going to fit. It's amazing. So, fun, or Help Me, Rhonda, one of those songs. And I just la 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 la, just la 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 la. That syllable, L-A, la 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 la. Well, apropos, since they're from L.A., Hawthorne, California, La La Land, as we call it here in Northern California, because we're envious of it, actually. Northern Californians have this inferiority complex. I've always wanted to live in Southern California, actually, not Northern California. And I'd love to live in Southern California in a lot of ways. But who knows? The grass is always greener. But anyway, la 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 la. la 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 do this la 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 la, and you can do all sorts of different stuff just off of one syllable, and that's vocalization practice. And this really tunes you towards Manjushri, who the quality that is gentle glory, but this beautiful voice and vocalization capabilities. Just, and so it's a great practice, vocalization. For me, it fulfills my creativity in a lot of ways. I feel very creative mind, but this kind of feeds it. It feeds. I say, I feel okay. I'm being creative, and I don't have to do something else. I can just do it while I driving to work or driving around or wherever you are at your computer. You don't have to be real loud or anything. You just use syllables. Do 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 Or you say woo, woo, woo. Or you can use just a vowel or a syllable, or so it's just all these endless combinations of vowels and syllables and sounds you can use to vocalization. You don't have to be lead singer. You're just kind of in the background singer. Or if you listen to different type of music, you can just do sounds. You if you want to be more sophisticated, you can, you know, if you want to be clever and fancy, you know, you can. That's fun too. But for me, I'm even more happy just as the smoothness of it. I was driving today and there was this full rainbow right in front of me, huge, and it was super wide rainbow. I was like, wow. And you know what was came on the CD? I was playing the best, you know, best hits of the Beach Boys, Don't Worry Baby, and the opening to Don't Worry Baby. Just whoa, and just like this moment, just like, oh my gosh, it just wowed me. That's on, and I'm driving into this massive, beautiful rainbow. I was greeted by rainbows this morning, and I just, oh wow, that is really wowish. And I said, that, you know, that's it. If you just, that beautiful rainbow sound, that smooth rainbow sound. Let the Beach Boys have that smooth sound, just my voice is terrible today, but when it's not terrible, I can get that smooth sound, and that really just resonates deeply. It deeply resonates. But the other stuff is fun too. It's not like you can't do it if you want to do something complex. but don't neglect just that, the ooh and the ah, wah, wah, ooh, ooh, ah, ah, wah, ooh, ooh, bum, 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 bum. You can just do anything you want. It doesn't have to sound good. Don't worry about it sounding good, because a lot of times your voice won't be good. For whatever reason, your voice just won't be good. Some days, it's good. My voice hasn't been good in a little while. I had a cold. My voice is strained now. It's just not good right now. But that doesn't stop me from vocalizing. Doesn't have to stop. You don't have to sound good. Don't worry about how you sound. It's the creativity that's important. It's the ideas in your mind, the creativity, that's important. So you feel like, whatever. You want to do, you know, what is that, electronic dance music? You could do that. Ambient. Sometimes I do ambient too. You can vocalize ambient. Bing, 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 bing. Whatever. You just, you know, you can vocalize anything. You can vocalize anything. You can vocalize a train. Cars, car passes you. It's a wet street. Just vocalize. Vocalize anything. You can vocalize anything. Bird singing. Sometimes I'll sing along with birds. Vocalize with birds. I hear a bird, and I'll just be riffing with the birds. I love the mockingbirds. They could sing anything, and I'm just twittering along right with them. I'm out of practice with that. You can vocalize anything. Even the plants, like swaying in the breeze, just you can just vocalize with that. How does that feel? How does that feel? So vocalization is this totally creative field, actually, where you can just express any sound combination you want, and you can combine that with balance practice too. Like you're like the plant. You're like this swaying in the wind. The palm trees, just, you know, how's that feel? Like a pedal steel guitar, and you can just back on one leg, kind of, and you know, just to vocalize the feeling. This is very creative. You can combine that with balance work. Yeah. But keep it simple. Keep it simple. Don't regiment it. Don't box yourself in. Don't regiment it. That's the one thing. I never like regimented, institutionalized stuff. Like, you can get into a dance troupe, right, where they learn this dance and everybody's doing this dance troupe stuff. But you're boxing yourself in. You should feel like a hummingbird, that you should just feel to drop anything an instant and then shift to some other vocalization or no vocalization or some movement where you feel, you know, you could just do something else. You're free to do anything else, anything, any movement, any vocalization, any instant. Be the hummingbird. So our totem animal, hummingbird. We could use hummingbird, really. If people say, what do you, you know, but I don't want to force that. It feels a little contrived. But, you know, hummingbird's a nice animal. Like, what's your favorite animal? Well, hummingbird, really. How they're so free in any direction, aren't they? They never are fixated. They seem so unfixated, the hummingbird. They can hover, they can fixate anywhere. Yet even in any fixation, they're unfixated, aren't they? You never feel like it's a permanent fixation. They're just present where they are. They're here, but they could be here or here or go backwards or forwards or anywhere instantly, right? Instantly. So, you know, the wings are there. So this is like spirit. Spirit can appear, can have any experience it wants, but it's never fixated in any experience or as any experience. It's never fixated as any experience. So I couldn't dance because I could never learn the dances because I always want to do something else. I'd say, well, I want to move this way. I want to move here. I feel like, you know, I feel like to stand it still right now, actually. No, you got to do the cha-cha-cha. Come on. One, two, cha-cha-cha. One, two, cha-cha-cha. One, two, cha-cha-cha. One, two, cha-cha-cha. And I want to go like one, two, a-cha-cha. A-cha-cha-cha. One, two. Cha-cha-cha. Stop. Cha one two, cha one cha cha one cha, cha cha one cha 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 one cha 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 one stop 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 stop. Spin goodbye. Is it dance instructor? No, come back. Come back. No. One two cha 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 one two cha cha cha. I said, well, I'm not a machine. Come on, I'm free. I'm free. I'm a hummingbird. So, I had a hard time learning. I said, wow, I'd rather my mind be free than, you know, be a machine. Machine language. I gotta learn, teach these machines how to function. You know, it's like, wait, that, why? I'd have to teach machines how to function. They're already pre-sanctified. Everything's sanctified. Everything's inherently sanctified. Everything's inherently sacred. We don't need to make anything sacred. Everything's inherently sacred. Everything is eternal life right now. It always has been. There's no way we can make it eternal life. How can we make something what it already is? This is an absurd redundancy. It's a contrivance. It's a contrivance. It's just an arrogant contrivance, an absurd, arrogant, redundant contrivance, silly whimsicality. It doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anything. It's like saying, I'm going to make the ocean wet. I'm pouring water into the ocean. What are you doing? I'm making the ocean wet. It's already wet. Whoa, what was that? Wow, that wasn't good. That was my neighbor. Something. Boom, what the heck was that? Shoot. Well, nobody's screaming, but I hear the car over there. That was a big kaboom. Like a wall fell or something. Wow. Well, there's somebody over there and they're okay, so. Yeah. This is distraction. That's okay. Distractions are sacred too. Everything's sacred. So I'm making the ocean wet. What? What are you doing? So like, it's like, imagine if you were like, for like millions of years, we've been like scooping water out of the ocean and pouring it into the ocean, scooping it out and pouring it in. This is what we've been doing. Just truly. What we've been doing is just as absurd. And so after millions of years, like so we ask ourselves, okay, what are we really doing? What are we doing here? Well, we're making the ocean wet. We're scooping, you know, scoop a glass of water, glass of liquid water out of the ocean, then pouring it back in. Scoop, pour. And then we're designing machines to scoop and pour. And we're saying, wow, we got to get more machines. We've got a whole bunch of robots and are scooping and pouring. We're fixated on the robots. Are you doing a good job, robots? What are you doing? I'm making the ocean wet. Okay. Okay, don't draw any conclusion. Don't draw any conclusion, one way or the other. Just let it be. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow of no conclusion, one way or the other, okay? Is that right or is it wrong? Should they be doing it or not doing it? No conclusions, no conclusion. I'm just aware we're scooping water out of the ocean and pouring it back in and saying we're making the ocean wet, okay? Just let that be present. Let that awareness, let that clarity just be present. That's all. Just let it be present. And we're not practicing present mind. We're just not drawing any conclusions about anything. Full stop in the wow. We're not drawing any conclusions. Okay, we got present mind now. No. We're not drawing that conclusion that we've reached something. Okay. It's just whatever is clarity is present rises. It is what it is. We're not drawing any conclusions. We refuse to draw any conclusions. Is it right? Is it wrong? Whatever. Just let it. We just say, okay, see it. Once you see it, then full stop in the wow. Block the panic of the fear of the abyss. Like, oh, you know, I've got the answer. What happened to the not answer? Where am I going into? Maybe I'm going into an abyss. You know, that will arise. Panic will arise. Panic will arise when you think you've won. Well, then what happens to the loser? You know, right? No conclusions. Winning, losing, no winning, no losing. I mean, I'm not concluding that I've won. I'm not concluding that I haven't won. I'm not concluding that I've lost. I'm not concluding that I haven't lost. So whichever way you want to look at it, I'm not concluding that I'm winning and losing. I'm not concluding that I'm losing and winning. I'm not concluding that I'm not winning and not losing. I'm not concluding that I'm not losing and not winning. There's just no conclusion being entertained here. No conclusion being entertained here. Time is it? Really? Seems later than that. it's cold and it's dark now and wet. No conclusion. Just so practice in this way. Just this. You'll have your hands full with that. That'll be more than enough to keep you occupied. Because you could use it all the time. Because the more you use it, the more clarity arises. So you don't worry. You say, well, I want to practice all day. Well, you could practice this all day, because if you do, the clarity will keep arising. As long as you keep practicing this way, the clarity will keep arising. Until you say, well, I've had enough. That's enough. That's enough. So, see, my weight was a little high this morning because I weighed myself early in the morning, that's why. It's a big difference between weighing yourself at 6:30 in the morning and 10:30. It's 4 hours of difference. You're gonna lose a lot of weight, actually, in between 6 and 10 in the morning, I think. I really feel that way. And if you wait until, like, noon and not eat anything, then your weight will really be down. But it was still pretty, it was still decent, really. And so I'm being very careful today of what I eat, and just trying, really trying to just keep that weight down. I actually ate a salad last night, mostly just lettuce. It wasn't very filling, but I did eat that. So I mean, if there's good food there, I'll want to eat it. But I have to remind myself just keep diluting the smoothie. I mean, that if you want a secret, okay, here's a weight secret again: dilute your smoothie, drink some, fill it back up to the brim with water, pour water in to dilute it to fill it to the brim, drink some more, is now down half again, pour water in, fill it up the top again, and so you get tremendous hydration this way. But as you go through the day, it's more water than thick smoothie. So start out the day with this really thick smoothie, and then as you drink some of it, dilute it, fill it back up with water. This is a great, great tip, nutrition tip for you, and a diet tip, all in one. You know, it's tremendous. You get the hydration, you get the the goodness of the kale protein smoothie, and you also get the diet all in one. It's like a three-in-one type of tip right here. So part of a success is to have skillful means and to have these tips and this advice, and it's just so helpful. It's so helpful, because what do we battle with? We battle with so much stuff in the world, don't we? But you use these skillful means, and you're not battling so much anymore, really. You kind of are smooth. Your life's kind of smooth, actually. It's kind of easy. So I know how to diet, okay? I know how to do nutrition. I know how to exercise. I know how to do be creative. I know how to do my spiritual practice, you know? So I know all this stuff. So it's smooth. I'm not floundering around. I'm not floundering. And as far as reading books, I don't need to read books. I don't read books. I don't need to. If I want to, I can open up open A Course in Miracles up, and all I need to read is one sentence, and I said, bingo, you know, that's it. Any sentence is all I need. It's right there. Everything Jesus says is right. Yeah, so just a word, just a sentence is enough. That's enough. That's it. But if you're practicing, drawing no conclusions at all, full stop in the wow, clarity just keeps arising, automatically from within. So you really don't need to read books. And if you're practicing this way, you don't even need to listen to me at all. Although I keep giving these tips, and so it's helping reinforce it's coaching. But really, you could just do it on your own, because the clarity will be arising from within you. It's already there. It's already totally there. There's no place it can go. Where can everywhere go to? It's already there. So it will arise automatically. You don't have to read anything, but you can if you want to. But I find less is more as far as reading goes, at least in the phase I'm in now. Less is more. So as far as what to do, sometimes I don't know. Let me sit down and just get into the wow mood. You know, nothing to do, get into the wow mood. Now I don't watch television at all. I don't listen to the radio at all. I don't look at any news at all. I don't look at any newspaper at all. I don't go internet any news or surf the internet, really. There's just a few sites I go to. I go to, if I have to Google something, I'll Google. But Facebook, a little bit to update Facebook. YouTube, to watch some videos. I even don't do that much. Magic Seaweed for surf videos. I go to there. And that's pretty much it. And Kazoa, if I make a slideshow, that's an online slideshow maker, I'll go there. But that's just work. That's editing work. But I do editing on YouTube. Other than that, I don't go to websites. I don't download anything, because every time I try, it's a disaster. Don't have a smartphone. Don't, do email or texting, unless absolutely necessary. Don't call people. I'm not on the phone ever. Don't get mail, really much mail. It's like a hermit kind of life, it's just smooth. But I'm right in the midst of Silicon Valley, functioning just fine. You don't need any of that stuff. You don't need any of that stuff. I get the weather report. Just go to Magic Seaweed, check the surf report, and they show whether it's going to be raining, what the weather's going to be for that hour. Every 3 hours, they give a wave. They show a wave and weather report, wind, and they'll show you whether it's going to rain, showers, or cloudy, or sunny. And I say, okay, it's probably going to be raining, okay. And it's pretty accurate. I mean, the surfers, they pay attention to accurate reports. They really are focused on that, because they don't want to be driving all over the place for wrong surf reports. So they put a lot of premium on getting it right. You know, if you say, hey, surfers, there's like 10-foot waves, great classy 10-foot waves up here, come on up. And we got this tamale stand for you, you know, and you go up there and the waves, it's all choppy, and there's no waves at all. The surfers will be really mad. I mean, they can get mad. I mean, they're kind of, you know, kind of brutal, beastie kind of folks. I mean, they say, hey, you know, you told us wrong, surf report, man. Oh, you know, don't do that again. We're gonna, and it's like they're you know, kind of rough and tumble types. And so, you know, you don't want to give a wrong surf report. That's not cool, really, is it? And they actually say, rate this surf report. How was our rating? How was our report? Rate it, please. Rate it, please. So they're not trying to hype stuff so much, like the weather on in the world now. It's just so much hype. It's ridiculous. You could throw a dart and do better than a lot of the stuff they're doing these days. Sometimes they get it right. They got this one right so far. I guess they couldn't miss this one. Couldn't miss it. It's impossible to miss. Although they'd say it would rain like an inch and a half. It's not raining anything like that. It's not heavy. It's just kind of, sort of showery, actually. You have to say it's showery. So in the wow, also say, don't say where you are. I'm not going to say I'm here. I'm not going to say I'm there. I'm not going to say it's an abyss. I'm not going to say it's not an abyss. Now, this might seem scary, but you can do it. You just say, I'm just not going to say where I am. I refuse. I refuse to look and assess where I am. I refuse to assess where I am. I refuse to draw a conclusion as to where I am. Did I fall into an abyss, or am I in paradise? I'm not going to draw any conclusion at all. Okay, so refuse to draw the conclusion you're in paradise. Refuse to draw the conclusion you're in an abyss, and anything in between. Just, I'm not going to assess where I am, draw any conclusion at all where I am. And you'll still be aware, oh, I'm breathing. Okay, I'm fine. I'm breathing, I'm fine. Okay? I'm breathing, I'm fine. Now, that may seem very daring, and it does. It does feel daring. So, as far as daredevil stuff, there's nothing more daredevil than full stop in the wow. It's sort of mentally daredevil-ness. Daredevilishness. Mental daredevilishness. Try that. Mental daredevilishness. Mental daredevilishness. Mental daredevilishness. Oh, you can do it. And it's like, wow, I'm not going to assess, you know, anything. I'm just not going to draw any assessments or conclusions or analysis at all. I'm just not going to do it. I'm not even going to say I'm here. No, no conclusions. Just wow. I'm just wow. Where am I? I'm just in the wow. Is where I am. I'm in the wow. So at least I'm in the wow. See, I'm in the wow. What am I? I'm the wow. Okay. What's right? Wow is right. Wow is right. Wow is right. I am the wow. I'm in the wow. I am the wow. And wow is right. Nothing more than that. 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 Woo, woo. Oh, the rain. How do you vocalize the rain? You could vocalize that somehow. You'd have to be very creative to do that. You'd have to be in the mood to do it. Talk about creative. I mean, it's just awesome. I never like to say I'm going to do something, because there, right, you box yourself in, right away, right? You box yourself in. In terms of creativity goes, like, I'm going to vocalize to the rain. Okay, now I box myself. Yeah, I mean, if I do, I do. If I don't, I don't. I want to be free to not do it also. I can just listen to it, or not. Right now, I prefer listening to it rather than vocalizing to it. Vocalizing to it is an option. Harmonizing with it, it's an option. Yeah. It's really raining pretty good now. What's going on? All right. Very great. We've covered a lot of tremendous ground here, as we need to do. Full stop in the wow. I've got to put some more water in this smoothie. In fact, I will right now. We can do this right now. Why wait? So you unscrew the lid. Green goop is there. I have some water here. Okay, and now I'll just pour the water in the smoothie. Beautiful. So, just brought it up now. Now I have a whole bunch more liquid to drink. See, but it's half water now. It's half more. It's whatever it was before. Well, half of just water has been put in there. Of course, that means less calories, right? Absolutely. Shake it up a little. Mix it up a little bit. Let's see how it tastes. Tastes great. As long as it looks green, you know it's good for you, right? Even though it's tasting more like water, but there's still a green taste there. Wow. Don't force yourself. The only issue is to be determined to practice full stop in the wow. Just I'm determined, absolutely determined, not to draw any conclusions. That's it. But it doesn't feel forced, because when you're determined to do that, you feel relaxed, actually. Like, oh, a big sigh of relief. There's tremendous relief when you take that position. Tremendous relief. I'm not going to draw any conclusions. You're free of this terrible burden of trying to draw conclusions. Just allow yourself to be free of that burden. It's wonderful. And I think I'm going to get inside. Before, because the wind is coming, I was like, oh, it's getting cold. Just stormy. And it's almost 2 hours long, right? All right, very great. I just keep on... No conclusions. So we will keep refining this, refining it. The parameters are here, the parameters are here, the parameters are here. You just keep getting familiar with it. Familiar says, you know what? That's pretty simple. It's very simple, isn't it? Very simple. Physical exercise, let me just work, make sure I'm doing balance work and let everything else revolve around my balance work. Nutrition, make sure I'm let's say, you know, smoothies, throw some greens in, spinach, kale, something. I'm doing the nutrition thing. Let everything else revolve around that. Whatever is fine. You can still have your pecan pie. And then practice full stop in the wow. Let everything revolve around that practice. Not drawing any conclusions. Mantra, wow, free and functional. Wow, free and functional. Manjushri, as far as the guru Manjushri. Okay. And what else? Whatever else we covered, but it's just, oh, vocalization and the creativity vocalization. Let everything, the creativity revolve around vocalization, okay? Revolve around vocalization. There you go. Vocalization, the Manjushri, the mantra, the spiritual practice, the nutrition, the exercise. And who you hang out with. It's okay that you do the opposite of what you're tendencies are. If you're real intellectual, maybe you want to be a little bit lowbrow. If you're lowbrow, you might want to hang out with the intellectual crowd or something, just to avoid getting sucked back into your primary defense against psychosis or attempt to attack it or get rid of it. So here we use super skillful means. Super skillful means. Super simple, super skillful. Super simple, super skillful. Okay. And remember to dilute your smoothie. That's really skillful beads. I mean, this is like one of the greatest tips in the history of humanity right here. And it's, I carry two things with me. I carry a full water bottle and a smoothie drink. And so I'll just keep, you know, diluting that smoothie drink during the day to the end of the day, and maybe just mostly water, you know, just like all this water, there's water in there, which is fine. But I make the smoothie to start out with really thick. Make it thick to start out with. Make it thick so that your dilutions, you know, can last the whole day. This is like a supreme weight diet trick. Yeah, it's just awesome. Super skillful means. We have super skillful means here. So be super smart, be super wise. Avail yourselves of these, of super skillful means. And that's how you qualify, you know, you qualify for the intensive, right? You have to be comfortable with skillful means. Comfortable, get comfortable with it. Ravana says the highest skillful means is silence. He says silence is actually perfect eloquence. Nothing else is as eloquent as silence. He's right. He's absolutely right. But that's very intense, isn't it? Silence, yeah. But we may, you know, who knows? Whatever. No conclusions. I'm not drawing any conclusions. But theoretically, that could come. That too could come. It could also not come. But it's certainly, I've seen, I saw what Ron was talking about. I got it. I said, oh, wow, yeah, wow. So it's totally true what he's saying. It's totally true. If you can handle silence, I mean, you have to be very, very qualified, pre-qualified to handle silence. You really have to be very pre-qualified. Your skillful means set has to be very good. Your life needs to be smooth. You really need to know, you know, to be able to really handle that, you have to really be top-notch. Get yourself very much pre-qualified for that. Now, is it possible? Theoretically, it's possible. Absolutely, it is. Yes, it is. I'm not going to predict anything, though, and as far as that goes, it's something you don't want to predict. You don't want to try and predict, you know. But yeah, it's within the realm of possibility. It certainly is. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. 2 hours? Oh, of course. Can't help it, right? I keep saying, okay, I gotta stop, but then another inspiration, more inspiration. Another log on the fire. Wow. So, super taping. Great to be here with you. We're just we're going towards this intensive together, really. You know, I get, you know, benefits from coaching everyone up here, and you know, I have to really bring it myself, of course. So yeah, it's super beneficial. Have some things arriving soon that, you know, we'll see how that works into the mix. But we have our basic parameters already set. We have our basic parameters set. And watch the creative videos too. We'll see how that goes. But there's some pretty profound videos there that actually help. Don't draw any conclusions. The foam videos help you draw no conclusions. They're very helpful for that. Very helpful. There's no conclusions to be drawn, are there? Yet everything's happening. Free and functional, right? Free and functional. But yeah, where's the conclusion? Right? They're super helpful that way. I mean, throw it on your big screen, you know, and just kick back and just watch it. We used to just watch lava lamps when I was younger. You sit on your waterbed, float on your waterbed, watch your lava lamp, and listen to, you know, some music. No conclusion, right? No conclusion. The only problem back then was because we were being trained to be robot monkeys. They wanted you learn. You got to come to the conclusion. This is the right answer. This is the conclusion. We're driving everywhere, all crazy, going crazy. You know, it's like destroying our youth, destroying our free mind, our free and functional. And so, people started taking drugs just so they couldn't learn. To block the learning. Kids take drugs to block the learning. It's kill, you know, it's make driving them psychotic. It's true. So, you know, you just want to take drugs, sit on your waterbed, listen to music, and watch the lava lamp. But you should do it without drugs. You should be mindful that this is a spiritual practice. It's just a lack of discipline. Using drugs is a very much a lack of discipline. It's a lazy lack of discipline, and a panic. It's a panic mode. You know, it's panic mode where you're not aware enough about what you're doing. There's too much going on. It's okay. No conclusion. It's okay. That's a high spiritual practice you're doing. Okay, so take it seriously. Don't just say, "Well, I'm just like goofing off and having fun." No, that's a high practice. It doesn't matter what age you are. You know, like I said, I'm 12 going on zero. Just allow yourself to be familiar with no conclusion, but in a free and functional way, so that you can take this into your everyday life also. Whereas if you're on drugs, when the drugs wear off, you feel the effect wear off, and now you're panicking again. Drugs are a negative spiral. They really are. You think they're giving you a big boost, but the price they extract is horrible. Horrible. And it's amazing that the younger generations do not learn from the older generations in this regard. I mean, we from the 60s, we wrote the book on all of it. And we, you know, we speak from perfect hindsight on all of it. And it's absolutely not the way to go. It's a disastrous way to go. And yet the young people are just embracing it like idiots. You know, it's just unbelievable how stupid they are. It's like, what, they're trying to prove that they're better than us? You know, how stupid. if facts are facts, you can't prove something's better than a fact. You know, drugs don't work. They don't work. They extract a horrible, horrible price. And every generation keeps paying the same stupid price all over again. You know, it causes the Dharma to lose momentum. You know, we want momentum to the Dharma. That means learn from the mistakes that others have made. Like I learned from the mistakes of my dad. It's saved massive amount of time for everybody. So, I mean, what the heck were the 60s about if not that we made a lot of mistakes, and that's a gift to the other future generations, and they spit on the gift. They rejected it. they rejected this Dharma gift of saying, hey, we went through this whole thing, and we know now what doesn't work. For sure, we know what doesn't work. Most of them are still not sure what does work. Here, we do now know what does work. So we both know what does work and what doesn't work. And that's a Dharma gift to future generations. You have to understand that Dharma is not just your generation, it's future generations. Like Longchenpa addresses future generations so much. He's very insistent on saying, look, I'm speaking here, but also I'm addressing you the centuries in the future. I'm addressing the best and the brightest of future generations in this world. I'm talking to you right now from where I'm at. See, that's the Dharma. So you have to learn from other generations that have come here, that have been here, who learned these lessons, who are passing on the wisdom of the Dharma, that you don't just repeat the same stupid mistakes all over again. The fool learns from their own mistakes, the wise learn from the mistakes of others. And the Dharma is wisdom. It's the passing down of wisdom. It's the momentum of wisdom. So, you know, it's just, I cannot tolerate those who say, no, I'm not going to listen to whatever, you know, any wisdom. I'm just going to do it all myself and learn. That's not the Dharma. That's not the Dharma. You're not in the flow of the Dharma. You have to listen. When the Dalai Lama says drugs are poison, listen to him. Fortunately, I listened enough to the Christian wisdom and the wisdom. I said, you know, they must have some wisdom here. You know, they must. You know, I'm not going to just shut myself off from the history of wisdom traditions. Now, when you're a kid, you're going to half listen to it and half not. Okay, but at least if you half listen, you're gonna be all right. Okay, it's the ones that really just say, the older generation, they're completely stupid. They don't know what they're talking about. Those are the ones that get in really bad trouble. You cannot let the arrogance of youth run away with your mind. You must put some limits on it. You must put limits on it. You say, well, it's fun to run away. No, it's not. Later, it's not fun. It's not fun. It's like, it's fun getting drunk. Oh, tomorrow you're going to have this terrible hangover. That's not going to be fun. Well, I'll just drink some more. Yeah, well, you get even worse hangover. Well, I'll drink some more. Well, you'll end up alcoholic and in the grave, you know. If you just look at those who do that way, and it's brutal. It's brutal. It's really brutal. And you've stalled the Dharma out. You've helped stall the Dharma out by doing that. So we have. I insist on, you know, wisdom here. And discipline and wisdom. You can't just be an idiot and qualify. You cannot qualify by being an idiot. You have to qualify by being dharmic. I call it being dharmic. You can't qualify by being non-dharmic. No matter how smart you are, you cannot qualify by being non-dharmic. Cannot. Dharmic. You could feel if you're dharmic, you have this gratitude will well up to those who came before, and you just, you know, have tears of gratitude towards them for all the efforts that they put in to help us out now. We are where we're at now because of the efforts of those who came before us. Okay? That's a fact. Whatever clarity we came into the world with, you know, we built that clarity in a previous life through the wisdom culture that was present in the world. The Dharma is present in the world, so you think you're doing it on your own. You're not. You're not. It's a collective effort. The Dharma is a collective effort. Whether we're together, bodies are together or not, it's still a collective effort. So I've benefited from everyone, from the totality of the Dharma. I am where I am because of that. Because of that. And I use that Dharma as a general Sanskrit term to cover all religious traditions, all efforts, wisdom efforts. I am where I'm at because of the efforts of those who've come before me. And also some of my efforts too. But my efforts alone would have fallen short for sure. No chance. No chance without the great Dharma efforts of the past. For instance, the Dharma kings, Buddha, for instance, the efforts that Buddha has put forth on behalf of all of us are absolutely extraordinary, immeasurable. We could not be talking the way we're talking right now if Buddha had never come here, you know, just, no. Well, or someone like Buddha, no. He that really fired the Dharma up here so much. And it continues. So we don't want to disgrace the Dharma by becoming non-dharmic and just throwing it all away and saying, you know, I don't need any, I can do it all on my own and I don't need to listen to anyone. That's ridiculous. That's arrogant. I always praise Christianity for the great virtues and efforts it has made over the thousands of years. It's been tremendous. The fact that it's in decline right now doesn't mean that I didn't derive great benefit from all the efforts of all the Christians in history. I most certainly have. I most certainly have tremendous benefits. So, it's this great collective effort, and we do our little part here. Okay, we do our little part here. But always have this gratitude in your heart. And it could be just general. You don't have to exhaustively catalog. You could just, you know, it's just express it in any which way you want to. It's there. It's being felt. It's there, okay? And it's all the Dharma wants is put it into practice, put the wisdom into practice, and pass it along. Just pass it along, and be an example. Be an example that helps increase the Dharmic presence for everyone. And God knows we need as much as possible in the world right now. Because some very non-dharmic spirits have come into the world. Where they're so arrogant and say, well, we don't need it. We don't need any of that stuff. Forget about the past. Forget. Let's just look at your smartphone and you're good. Yeah. Very non-dharmic folk spirits, actually. So, we keep the gratitude. We keep it alive. We keep it alive. We keep the gratitude within us. As we do our practice, we are adding to the potency of the Dharma. We really are. Keep that in mind. Everything you're doing, take it seriously. As you're doing those balance exercises, you are adding to the Dharma. You're being dharmic, actually. When you're putting in this context of pre-intensive, you're being dharmic. Very dharmic, actually. You have a dharmic goal. You want to get into a full intensive, right? Of some sort. We're not labeling how it has to be or anything, okay? So you're really adding to the momentum of the Dharma. You really are. You are part of it. You absolutely are part of it. Don't even question that. Okay, very great. That's it.